Consider this. You're walking through a Walmart supercenter, or maybe it's a Target or your local privately owned department store. Everything around you looks just as you would expect, until you reach one particular aisle. There, laid out before you in rows of colorful boxes and canisters, are dozens and dozens of brand new action figures from the Lego toy line known as Bionicle. At first, you're excited to find these toys, excited to a degree you can't quite explain, and you plan to buy as many as you can carry. It doesn't occur to you until later that Bionicles haven't been in active production for over 10 years. By the time you realize this, you've already woken up. The Bionicle dream is a shockingly common occurrence among young adults who followed LEGO's groundbreaking action figure line as children. The details change, but the circumstances are always the same. The dreamer comes across a cache of Bionicle toys, maybe unopened in a department store, maybe used in their basement, and experiences an almost indescribable mix of emotions, dominated by one feeling in particular: nostalgia. The Bionicle dream has been widely documented on social media and recognized as an existing phenomenon even by those who have never experienced it. As apparent proof of its existence as a meme, in the original sense of the word, most posts about the dream claim that the original poster thought they were the only one who ever experienced it, and most of the comments will say the same. The Bionicle-based YouTube channel, Legomation Studio, recently released a video covering the Bionicle dream, in which they break down the basic premise of the meme and introduce the shared discussion among fans. In this video, Legomation Studio posits that childhood fans of other franchises, such as Transformers or Disney, have their own version of the dream. However, research into this topic has shown that the dream, as a concept, is only actually relevant in the Bionicle community. Every beloved franchise has inspired countless other non-recurring dreams for their fans, but one shared dream experience often enough to be notable is apparently exclusive to Bionicle, to the point where Urban Dictionary refers to the phenomenon as simply the dream, without even specifying its connection to a franchise in the article title. In theory, the dream doesn't have to be specific to Bionicle, but according to the internet, it is. Which begs the question, why? What makes Bionicle stand out from hundreds and thousands of other toy lines to the point where its fans are still literally dreaming about buying its products well into adulthood?
On the island of Mata Nui, six mighty Toa must rise against evil.
Bionicle was never the most well-known or best-selling toy line of its time, despite being produced by the largest toy company in the world. In the late 90s, LEGO had fallen on hard times and decided on a Hail Mary maneuver to save their company. A new toy series based on their Technic line, which would follow a strict storyline and utilize a multimedia format. LEGO were hesitant about breaking their long-standing rules regarding the use of weapons and violence in their sets, but they were desperate for a new line that didn't involve paying royalties to franchise owners. They ultimately decided that themes of war and violence were permissible as long as there was a clear distinction between good and evil. The final product was a line of humanoid Technic figures that were given individual names, personalities, and abilities through an ongoing storyline told across novels, comic books, online games, and even straight-to-video feature films. Validating LEGO's initial misgivings, Bionicle became increasingly dark and mature, with the novels depicting scenes of violence, murder, sadism, and attempted genocide. The tone was grim, and the lore was complex. Despite being rated for children as young as 8, Bionicle felt, at the time, like a genuine grown-up epic, closer to The Lord of the Rings than Pokemon. The first wave of Bionicle was released in 2000 and 2001, and the storyline came to an end with the release of the final wave in 2010. Although the original sets came out a mere 23 years ago, the world was a very different place when we were first introduced to the Toa, the Rahi, and the island of Mata Nui. Touchscreen phones were a distant fantasy. The PlayStation 2 reigned supreme. Only 3 Harry Potter books had been released, and the world was blissfully unaware of the upcoming tragedy that would change our way of life. At the time, kids weren't as overexposed to franchise media and pop culture as they are today. Superhero movies were hit or miss at the box office, and shared cinematic universes only existed for Universal Monsters and kaiju films. Children's franchises like Transformers and Pokemon included ongoing storylines and characters with distinguishable personalities, but with less of a focus on continuity and definable lore than today's media. When Bionicle came on the scene, it brought the best of all worlds. The building functionality of Lego, the sci-fi aesthetic of Transformers, the collectability of Pokemon, and the endless character versus character debates familiar to superhero fans. On top of all that, Bionicle retained a strict continuity across its many storytelling formats, to the point where certain scenes would even be recreated multiple times with identical dialogue to maintain consistency. With such complicated lore, kids could really lose themselves in the fictional world. It's one thing to build a custom Lego set, but another to build your own Bionicle character and use your knowledge of the Bionicle universe to provide them with a backstory that fits with pre-established canon. Although its complicated lore and ongoing storyline were quite likely a vehicle to Bionicle's success, this setup was also the key to its downfall. In 2009, LEGO cited the decade-long mythology as a major reason that the franchise was no longer attracting new buyers. They announced that Bionicle would run its final wave in early 2010, and subsequently end production. Thankfully, the major storyline was already gearing up for its finale, and was allowed to end on the writer's terms, if a little earlier than planned. Although Bionicle was officially canceled by LEGO to make way for newer, fresher toy lines, its final season provided a satisfying story conclusion to a decade's worth of character arcs and world building. As interest in Bionicle waned, it became clear that it wasn't just the younger kids who weren't buying. Older fans who had been there since the beginning were no longer invested. Kids born in the mid-90s were now in high school, while the ones who got into Bionicle a little later were reaching their double digits and moving on. While adults can look back on their childhood toys with nostalgia, it's not uncommon for older kids to totally distance themselves from anything considered childish. This would have been the experience of many Bionicle fans, who suddenly considered themselves too mature for toys, even toys with such dark themes and interesting lore. Other fans legitimately got bored with the franchise and turned their attention towards new interests. But now, 13 years after the series ended, and almost two decades since many fans lost interest, one shared experience unites a huge percentage of former Bionicle kids. The nostalgic desire to return to those days. Nostalgia for childhood is hardly uncommon, especially as the world seems to grow more complicated around us. But something about Bionicles in particular, and how we felt playing with them, seems to elicit stronger, more devastating feelings of nostalgia in those of us who loved and lost the franchise as children. Is it really a series of buildable action figures we long for in our adult lives, and even in our dreams? Or is it something more abstract? The answer to these questions, like so many others, may be related to when exactly we were born.
In the city of Metronui, you can discover how six new heroes confront the danger and protect the inhabitants from a mysterious force.
Over the last 10 years, generational divides have grown stronger and more pronounced than ever before. With the growing Cold War between baby boomers and millennials has come new stereotypes and divisive opinions on both sides. Meanwhile, as Generation X is totally ignored, Generation Z grows up in the shadow of the millennials and tries to find their place in this chronically divided world of ours. It's not uncommon for older people to consider anyone under the age of 30 to be a millennial, despite plenty of millennials already hitting 40. And the word has become a shorthand for ignorant youth. However, the role of the young, incomprehensible generation has now been totally filled by Gen Z, who delight in reminding the millennials that they're now closer to middle age than teenhood. Older people tend to blur the line between millennials and zoomers, but for the two younger generations, the distinctions are starkly apparent. Millennials part their hair on the side, zoomers part their hair in the middle. Millennials watch Friends, Zoomers watch The Office. Millennials grew up with AOL Instant Messenger, Zoomers grew up with TikTok. Millennials went into massive debt to pay for college, Zoomers learned everything they need to know for free by watching Rico Talks. Generational divides are more apparent nowadays than they've ever been, and both of the younger generations seem content in their division. But, much like politics, while the two opposing camps are yelling at each other, those in the middle of the spectrum are totally ignored. Since generational cohorts are very loose designations, there will always be those who aren't sure which group they belong to. These people, born in between the clear grouping of generations, are known as cuspers. People born in the mid to late 60s are cuspers between the baby boomers and Generation X. People born in the mid to late 70s are cuspers between Generation X and the Millennials. The latest batch of cuspers, born in between Millennials and Gen Z, have been dubbed Zillennials. The phonetic laziness of this portmanteau is not insignificant. Born in the mid to late 90s, Zillennials will have grown up with older technology like blocky desktop computers, flip phones with little antennas, and magic devices that could guess the answer to any 20 questions game. They may remember 9/11, and probably owned an iPod Nano, but they don't identify with the Beanie Baby generation, and they probably don't understand half the slang being used today. Just as Zillennials aren't grandfathered into the only 90s kids remember the 90s mantra, they weren't quite old enough to identify with aughts culture. And by the time the 2010s rolled around, Generation Z was blossoming into the newest incarnation of irritating tweens. The Zillennial class isn't considered a legitimate generational cohort, to the extent that any generation is more than just an arbitrary grouping, but being caught in between two opposing, cartoonishly culture-driven generations, many young adults born in the late 90s can't help but feel left out. Some may say that generational labels are actually a detriment to society and cause unnecessary divide among people who already have plenty of reasons to resent each other. In 2021, sociologist Philip Cohen wrote to the Pew Research Center think tank, encouraging them to cut out their hardline distinctions between boomers, Gen X, millennials, and Gen Z. Cohen claimed that while one's year of birth is very important in determining the trajectory of their life, generational labels and their associated stereotypes only serve to increase hostility between the minority of age groups who actively identify with one of these cohorts. And while this is plainly true, 30 seconds on social media will show that millennials and zoomers are at each other's throats over the tiniest cultural differences, the fact is that generational labels aren't going anywhere. It's possible that in the future people will put less importance on which generation they belong to, but currently, whether or not these labels hurt us as a culture, no one is going to convince our militant generations to break free of their chosen roles. Boomers are the establishment. Gen X have never gotten their time to shine. Millennials are rebellious to a fault. Zoomers gave up a long time ago. And Zillennials are stuck in the middle, not only without their own sense of identity, but without even being recognized as a class that exists. Given the time in which it was produced, Bionicle is the closest thing to a true cultural landmark for Zillennials. The oldest Millennials would have been almost 20 when the first wave hit shelves, while the oldest Zoomers would have been a few years unborn. Assuming the median age of Bionicle enjoyers stayed consistent, the franchise would have opened on a customer base of younger Millennials and ended staunchly in the Zillennial category, with true Zoomers being only a few years old during the final wave. Someone born in 1997, a year that is classified as both Millennial and Gen Z, depending on who you ask, would have been 4 when Bionicle debuted and 13 when it ended. The perfect age to grow up aware of the franchise, discover its potential and become a diehard fan, and eventually declare themselves too mature for toys by the final few years. Of course, it would be ridiculous to claim that people born in between the two generations never experienced the same shifts in culture as younger millennials, or that no one born in the late 90s ever watched Euphoria. In fact, to be a child in the aughts meant not to even recognize generational divides, at least not as significantly as we do today. Before the rise of Gen Z's cultural identity starkly defined the previous generation, Zillennials were just the younger kids. The kids who hadn't watched Saved by the Bell or played Pokemon Red and Green on a black and white Game Boy. They were the loose, unnamed collection of children who had yet to discover a shared sense of identity. Being children, of course, this wasn't a conscious thought for them, but retroactively, it seems clear that people born in the late 90s were always destined to be sandwiched in between the two most cartoonish and militantly petty generations in living memory. There would be no labels, no shared memories, no cultural touchstones to bring them together and protect them from the lighthearted civil war being waged by their older and younger siblings. Looking back on children of this time period, it seems almost too apparent that so many of them would find their true selves in a complicated and emotionally stirring fantasy world. Despite a 2009 statistic showing that 45% of boys aged 6 to 12 owned Bionicle sets, while 85% of them were aware of the franchise, Bionicle never felt like a worldwide phenomenon. Most kids at school owned a set or two and enjoyed taking them apart and putting them back together, but only a fraction of that 45% really understood. To know the mythology beyond just the word Makuta and the concept of mask powers was a special privilege, available to all, but only accepted by a few. Subscribers to LEGO Magazine could read the monthly Bionicle comic books, but how many had also bought the novels, played the online game, or even seen the movies? For those who had, the legend of the Bionicle was more than just a toy line. It was our mythology, our shared cultural legends, our own sort of pantheon of deities and heroes who were not only more appealing than the human-shaped gods we learned about in school, but more complex as well. Despite nearly every wave of Bionicle consisting of six action figures in the same color schemes, every single one of them was given a human personality and relatable faults by the strongly written novels and comic books. This may be all that's needed to explain why the series meant so much to kids who happened to be the right age at the right time. These superpowered cyborgs from a magical world of evil spirits and planet-sized robots felt more human than most other characters we knew. While they were divided into a simple good-evil dynamic, the good guys weren't always in the right, and often gave into the fallacy of doing the wrong thing for the right reasons. They were heroes we could look up to as children, but also humanized characters we could relate to as we matured and realized that morality isn't always black and white. And as Bionicle's fans matured, so did the franchise itself, introducing a grittier edge and darker themes, even touching on such topics as suicide, fascism, and eugenics. While TV shows like Avatar The Last Airbender, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and Teen Titans had already shown us dark premises and masterfully developed characters, Bionicle alone seemed willing to take a step further and introduce children to true evil, possibly thanks to the much looser censorship of children's novels and comic books compared to children's TV. And the creators weren't unaware of this shift. LEGO purposefully toned down the color schemes of the toys, visually implying that the already mature storyline would be edging into darker territory. And for certain kids, born at the right time, this edge into maturity happened concurrently with their own adolescent desire to be viewed as grown up. Ironically, the very desire that may turn them away from Bionicle and other childhood loves. Although Bionicle introduced children and young adolescents to extremely dark themes, the series never lost sight of LEGO's original demand, that a line be drawn between good and evil. Along with depraved villains such as Makuta Teradax, Rudaka, and the Shadowed One, came heroes such as Takanuva, Toa Matoro, and, ultimately, the god of the Matoran universe, Mata Nui himself. These heroes struggled in their fight against evil, but more often than not, they first had to struggle not to fight amongst themselves. The Toa Nuva were surly, introverted, and set in their ways. The Toa Mecher were scared children thrust into a terrifying world where they suddenly had to fend for themselves. The Toa Inaika were prodigies who leapt into action and found themselves totally out of their depth. Looking back on it, the individual characters aged extremely well. They're almost more relatable for adults than they were for children. As kids, we may not have understood the pressure of adulthood reflected in the Toa's arcs, but we did understand that these weren't your average kid show characters. They were the good guys, plain and simple, but they weren't the goody two-shoes of classic Marvel or the unflappably moral Jedi of the original Star Wars. Unlike the majority of modern toy lines, even by LEGO, in which the good guys are presented as boring bureaucratic do-gooders, and the bad guys are presented as badass weapon-wielding killers, Bionicle managed to keep its young fans erring on the side of morality, ironically by not depicting its heroes as infallible vessels of goodness. The mythology, the character development, the time and the place, and of course the toys themselves, they all melded together into an ongoing childhood experience that wasn't easily forgotten, even if no conscious connection is drawn between Bionicle and the Zillennials' place in our culture. To this day, a huge number of former Bionicle kids have grown past their need to look mature and resumed their diehard fandom, joining online communities and scouring secondhand sites for old sets. Many of them still have their childhood figures. But for a tragic number of Bionicle kids, myself included, their sets were lost long ago. Personally, I sold almost all my Bionicles at a yard sale when I was 11 or 12. At the time, I told myself I was too old to play with toys, and that I needed the cash for more mature activities. I assured myself that they really were just toys, and that I wouldn't regret getting rid of them. Of course, I was wrong, and the realization that I had sold almost all my Bionicles to a stranger hit me harder than anything I'd experienced before in my young life. I genuinely thought it would feel just like selling any other toy, but really, it felt like selling a piece of my childhood. My childhood, which was still in full swing whether I liked it or not. I was only 11 or 12, but I felt the first pangs of what I would later recognize as nostalgia. Not nostalgia for a distant decade or a place I used to live, but for a time in my life when everything was simple, when I was protected by people who were stronger and wiser than me, and when I believed the world could be as simple as good versus evil. That's the thing about growing up. We feel the pressure of being a Toa, but deep down, we're just older and sadder Matoran.
New Lego Bionicle. Legend tells of a mask with unspeakable power. But evil has taken the mask to unleash an army of skull spiders.
The definition of the Bionicle dream is a dream in which one unexpectedly finds a large group of Bionicle sets. Usually, these dreams are set in a retail location such as Walmart or a Lego store, usually wherever the dreamer used to buy Bionicles as a kid, but sometimes the sets are discovered in bizarre places. A commenter on the r/BionicleLego subreddit describes finding sets in dream replications of their attic, their front lawn, and a baseball game. Personally, my Bionicle dreams have ranged from normal spots such as my local Walmart or a flea market, to unexpected situations like a room in my childhood home that never really existed, containing all the Bionicles I never had. When I first started planning this video, I made a post in the r/BionicleLego subreddit asking about experiences with the Bionicle dream. I also asked for everyone's ages and a brief history of their fandom. As expected, most people who gave their ages were born between the tail end of the Millennial generation and the beginning of Gen Z. Plenty of comments came from younger fans who discovered Bionicle after it ended, or fans of the 2015 reboot, which is a totally different video. Most of these comments admitted that they had never experienced the dream, or only on rare occasions. There seemed to be not just a correlation to age groups, but a loose parallel between the frequency of the dream and specific age. The older fans, who consciously experienced Bionicle as far back as 2001, had the dream more frequently than those who were introduced to the franchise later on. Aside from location, another variable in the dream is the type of sets available. Sometimes, as with Reddit user Classic Jondor, the dream sets are Bionicles that really existed. In Classic Jondor's case, every single set from 2001 to 2010. Other times, such as with Reddit user Night Train to Nowhere, the sets are totally fictional, but desirable to a longtime fan. Another Reddit user recounts a dream in which they found a supply of Bionicle-themed merchandise other than the actual toys. Merchandise that never existed in real life. Despite all the variations of the dream, one element remains consistent: the strong emotions present throughout, and more importantly, afterwards. Finding Bionicles in a store, or anywhere else, is accompanied by a sense of excitement, the same kind of excitement one would feel when buying them as a child, but mixed with the vague dream knowledge that the scenario is no longer possible, and hasn't been for 13 years. This knowledge is usually present on some level, even when the dreamer appears as a child, something that I believe occurs roughly half the time, according to the small sample size I was given on Reddit. Sometimes, the dreamer's their current age in the dream, and excitedly believes that they have discovered a secret stash of Bionicles in the current year. Sometimes, they're reverted to childhood, and don't quite understand the nostalgia conjured up by the presence of these toys that, based on their environment, should still be in production. Either way, the dream is almost universally followed by a sense of loss, and sometimes plain sadness. No matter how many Bionicles you came across in your dream, no matter if you believed with all your heart that they were real, you still have to wake up and realize that the dream is over. And it has been for more than a decade. If this all seems shockingly melodramatic, well, it is. But it's a melodrama that I personally am willing to accept as part of my identity, now that I know I'm not alone. The fact that Urban Dictionary and YouTube and social media show no evidence for such a thing as a Transformers dream or a Pokemon dream or a Ninja Turtles dream shows me, almost to a scientific point, that Bionicle was something special. And at the risk of sounding like a pretentious indie fan, the truth is, you had to be there. It's not as if someone who never played with Bionicles is by definition leading a less fulfilling life, even if they happen to be stuck in between warring generations. But to put it simply, if you know, you know. And for those of you who do know, you also know that, as hard as it is to accept, there's no going back. We can join online fan communities, we can spend hundreds of dollars on eBay, we can even read PDFs of the old novels and comic books. But outside the dream, there's no chance of reliving the kind of excitement and sense of belonging we were granted by a silly little story about robots with magic powers. As adults living in a post-Bionicle world, we can still appreciate the complex mythology, the well-written characters, the technical feats of the toy designs, but our childlike wonder and excitement have been buried by the responsibilities of the grown-up world. No further proof of this is needed than all the people online claiming that they couldn't afford the sets in their dreams. Even in a fantasy world where we're reverted to childhood, the financial stress of adult life has overtaken childlike excitement. Those indescribable feelings we used to take for granted aren't gone. They're just hidden, deep down, in a part of our psyches that even bills and gas prices can't chip away at. The sad truth is that the dream will always end. But the upside is that, short as it may be, the dream still allows us to briefly experience the joy and wonder of childhood. The same can be said for our memories of real-life childhood, and, for some of us, the joy of being a Bionicle fan. It all had to end eventually, but that doesn't mean we can't remember it fondly. I'm not here to tell you exactly what the dream means on a metaphorical or psychological level. I'm not a psychologist or a sociologist, but I am a Zillennial, and I am a Bionicle fan. I've watched as the cultures of Millennials and Zoomers have become more distinct and flanderized, as both groups struggle to define themselves in an ever-changing world where the odds are always stacked against them. I've never been able to comfortably fit into either generation, or identify with their cultural landmarks. This meant nothing to me as a child, but looking back on my life, I can recognize that I wasn't part of any strictly defined decade of pop culture. What I can see is that Bionicle came at exactly the right time for me, and unlike all the other franchises of the era, it ended up teaching me actual life lessons that weren't forced or trite or boxed into the condescending mindset of children's media. Bionicle may be over, along with our childhoods, but the lessons it taught us live on. The toys may no longer be available in stores, outside of our dreams, but stories never die. Even stories written to help a Danish toy corporation out of financial troubles. Most of us will have kids of our own someday, if we don't already, and even if we don't have any Bionicles left to pass on to them, we still have the mythology, and the memories of how it made us feel to be a part of something wonderful. Every so often, we can return to those unexplainable feelings of childlike wonder in our dreams. But in real life, we have to remember that endings don't invalidate experiences. Those of us who really understand will never forget what Bionicle meant to us, and will always remember that, as a wise man once said, even when your hope is gone, move along, just to make it through. I guess I should thank everyone who participated in my little Reddit survey, but first I should probably apologize for letting an entire year go by before I actually got cracking on this video. Unfortunately, motivation doesn't come easy in the early days of a channel, but I hope to have the videos come a little more consistently from now on. If you like this video, go ahead and throw me a like and subscribe, and if you thought it was pretentious and redundant, well, might as well let everyone else figure that out for themselves. If you'd like to read through it at your own pace, you can download a PDF of the essay with sources cited in the description. And if you're interested in seeing my embarrassingly extensive pop culture knowledge translated into literature, please check out my website at natnelson.com, where you can find all my short stories and links to my books. I'm actually working on a new novel at the moment that doesn't technically involve Bionicles, but utilizes the kind of nostalgic, liminal space aesthetics I touched on in this video, but in the context of psychological horror. So if that sounds like something you're interested in, then keep your eyes peeled. I also have a personal channel focusing on my own writing and horror in general, and I'd love to see you over there sometime.